Sorry about that. Hello, everybody, and welcome to our weekly language clinic. My name is Neil, and I have the next 45 minutes or so to answer all of your questions about learning English. Like it says in the post, you can ask about anything. You can ask about grammar, vocabulary, spelling, pronunciation, or wider questions about, you know, literature or movies or TV or music or anything you'd like to ask about life in the UK, food. There's no limit. I love talking about anything and everything. So whatever questions you've got to ask, I will try and answer them over the next 45 minutes or so. For people who are new to this, who are watching for the first time, the first thing I'd like to ask you to do is to just say hello in the comments and say where you're watching from. I always like to know what countries are watching because every week it's different and, you know, we get more and more countries. And sometimes, you know, it's really nice when we see a new country for the first time. And of course, it's nice when we see all our old friends that come every week that we see all the time. So just say hello, say where you're watching from. And then if you have any questions, think carefully about your questions, ask them in the comments, and I'll try to answer as many as I can. I can see I've got a couple of people joining already from Myanmar saying there, from Daily Life Cooking Style and Julia. At the moment, I seem to only be seeing people from YouTube, so that's worrying me a little. If you're watching this on Facebook, which I hope some of you are, then make sure you say hello and tell me you're out there. Okay. Ah, there we go. Coming in now, okay, from Nepal and Chile and Sri Lanka, Sudan, Italy. Okay, that's more like it. You had me worried there for a moment. I thought no one was watching. Okay, Indonesia, Sudan, I mentioned already. Yep, Italy there. Okay, great. Uh-huh, Myanmar again. Mm-hmm. Peru, Algeria. A couple from Peru. That's good. I'm glad to see we're reaching an audience in Peru. I've always wanted to go to Peru. Maybe someday I'll get there. Okay. And a whole bunch of others. Okay. So for everyone who's just joined, as I said, I'm here to answer your questions. It's not about what I want to talk about. It's what you want to talk about. So whatever you want to ask, just put the questions into the comments and I will try to answer as many as I can. I'm going to start with answering some questions from the earlier language clinic that I didn't get around to at the time. So I'm going to start with a couple of these because some of them are really quite interesting. Okay, simple one first from Ali Sabri Mohammed. He ran money. Can you help me? Okay, easy one here. He ran out of money. It means he didn't have any money left. It's a phrasal verb for that, to run out of something. You can run out of money, you can run out of time, you can run out of petrol, you can run out of anything. You can run out of sugar, in anything. When you've used all that you have and you don't have any left, then you run out of something. So that's a nice quick one there. Hold on. Ovin Sharia is asking, please talk us through about Oxford comma and its usage in punctuation. Okay, I'll do this very quickly. I'll tell you now, I personally don't use the Oxford comma at all. And to be honest, I think in British English, although it's called the Oxford comma because it's a rule from Oxford University Press, from the publishers from that they use in all of their publications and all of their books and all of their articles and so on with that. It's more common in the US and in American English than British English, although people use it everywhere. And what it is when you make a list, I like music, poetry, film, and travel. Okay, when you make a list like that, you either have a comma before the and at the end, or you don't. Now, I don't usually, 90% of the time. And I think in British English, that's the most common. So we would say, I like music, comma, art, comma, cinema, comma, sa. Sorry, I was doing the opposite. Music, comma, art, comma, cinema, and travel. No comma. But some people think there should be a comma after the last item. So it's I like music, comma, cinema, comma, art, comma, and travel. Okay? Now, most of the time, it's up to you. If you want to use it, you can use it. The only time that you should use it is when the last item can be confusing. So for example, maybe the second last item, you know, something like fish and chips, okay? They go together very often. Now, if the chips I'm talking about at the end were, for example, I don't know where I get these examples from. They just come up. Let's say they were casino chips, not potato chips, okay? Then it would be confusing at the end if I said fish and chips with no comma. But if I put the comma, then it separates the last two items and makes it clear that they're not together. So that's the only time that you should use it. But as I say, I don't use the Oxford comma. I think most people in British English don't use it that much, but it's very, very common in American English. So, you know, it's up to you. Okay, right. Lots of questions have come in while I've been doing that. So that's great. Okay, this is a teacher question and it's a big question. So I'm not going to talk about it for long, but I will direct you towards our Teaching English Facebook page, where you will find a lot of discussion of this kind of question and a lot of different opinions and ideas. The question is, would you consider the use of L1, that means the language of the learner, in teaching English, positive or negative? To what extent? That sounds like an essay question, and I don't have time to answer an essay right now. I have no objection to the use of the learner's language in teaching if it can be helpful at certain points. You know, I mean, if it can make things, you know, if you're asking someone to do something, to do some task in English, then you want them to do it in English, of course. But if there's something you can do to just help the preparation or something to make that easier so they can focus on the task, why not? Okay, that would be my opinion. So it depends on the situation. Okay, right, let's see. Udaya is saying, is there a rule of pronunciation of do and go? Well spotted, Udaya. I mean, those are two. I'm having trouble speaking English today. I'm sorry about this. I will try harder. I'll work harder in future. Let me start again. Those are two-letter words spelt with basically the same spelling pattern exactly, a consonant and a vowel O, and they're pronounced differently, do and go, okay? So no, there is no rule that can help you with that type of word and that type of difference in pronunciation in English. You really just have to learn the pronunciation of the words. Check it, by all means, check it with an online dictionary, with any of the resources that there are out there. But there's no simple rule that you can say, this is why do is spelt that way, and this is why go is spelt that way. No. And that's true for a lot of pronunciation questions in English. They have developed in a certain way because of many reasons, because of history and because of the origins of the words that you're working with. But, you know, you could perhaps, for sometimes you can make complicated rules, but really, most of the time, or many times, there are no rules at all, and you just have to learn them as they are. Okay, let's move on. Julia has a question here. I haven't read it yet, so I hope I can. I hope by the time I get to the end of it, I can answer it. What is the difference between "I wish I would pass the exam with flying colors" or "I wish I had passed the exam with flying colors"? Let me think about the first one first. I wish I would pass the exam. I personally would not use the first one. I can't think of a context where I would use the first one. And to be honest, when we're talking about something in the future, hope is more common, because if I say this is an interesting question. If you say "I wish I would pass the exam," the sense that gives me is not talking about the past. Okay. It's not really possible to use that to talk about the past. Maybe you're thinking about would and used to talk about past habits or something like that. But if you say that to me, I get the, you know, it gives me the impression that you're talking about something in the future that you haven't taken the exam yet, but that is yet to happen. And you know, that's not really possible. When we talk about the future, we would use hope instead of wish. You know, I hope I can pass the exam. To talk about the past, you couldn't say I wish I would in that way. Okay. It's not possible. So I wish I had passed the exam with flying colors means very simply that you did not pass the exam is passed. It's finished. You did not pass with flying colors. Maybe you passed. It's not clear, but you didn't pass with flying colors, meaning you did not get a very high mark in the exam. That one is fine. But the first one, I would simply say, don't use it. Okay. If you're talking about the future, use hope. If you're talking about the past, then use I wish I had in that way. Okay. Let's see. Okay. More questions. When I look at one set, hold on. Hadir, they married to something children. I'm not quite sure what you mean, but you've added another comment here. Okay. Would simply be have. They married to have children. It would be the verb that you would use there. Not get, not bring. Okay, they married to have children. It's a little odd, they married to have, because married to is usually used in a different sense with that. So it might be better to say, to add a couple of words and say something like, they married in order to have children. Okay, but the verb is still have. It's they married to have children. Okay. Okay, Zubir Belam Sanyang, what's the difference between used to and was? Was is a single verb. Was is the past tense of be. Okay, and now so you can use it to talk about any past sentence when you're talking about when you're using the verb be. I was shy when I was a child, for example. I was I don't know what the film was good. Something like that. Any sentence that you're using to talk about the past with the verb be, then you can use was. Used to is different. Used to goes together with another verb. So remember I said a minute ago, I was shy when I was a child. Then to use used to, we have to add the verb. I used to be shy when I was a child. It's followed by the infinitive like that. Okay. And both are possible. There is no difference in the meaning for that particular example. You can say a simple fact, I was shy, and you can say I used to be shy. The only difference, slight difference, is used to be maybe makes it clearer that you're not shy anymore. So in that sentence, you can use both, but used to has to also have the verb be. I used to be shy. Otherwise, used to and was are totally different, okay? Because you can use used to with any verb. I used to have a dog when I was young. I used to ride a bicycle to school when I was young. You know, any verb can go after used to, not just be. Okay, so that's the difference there. Okay. Okay. I'm going to do this one, Yumna Ayub. It's a little bit long, but I think I can do it quite quickly. Yumna's asking, can I give you a simple explanation how to use past perfect continuous as a meaning in context? Is it useful to describe a long action verb in the past? Okay, let me try and do this as quickly and clearly as I can. The important thing here is the word continuous. Okay, we have different continuous verbs. Third mistake in English today. Honestly, I need to go to classes. We have different continuous tenses in English: present continuous, past continuous, present perfect continuous, past perfect continuous, etc. But they all have one thing in common, which is that the continuous describes some action, or state, could be state as well, but describes some action which continued for a long time, a longer time, which went on for a longer time, or was repeated again and again over a period of time. Okay? And very often it's contrasted. It goes together with verbs in the past simple when we're talking about past continuous. Okay, so for example, I lived in Cambodia for 10 years. Okay, I would not use the past continuous tense there. It's a finished time. It was a long time, but the whole action I'm talking about is something that is done like that. But if I was talking about something that happened to me, then I can say when I was living in Cambodia, there I'm describing a longer time. Okay, and I could say I met some very nice people. Okay, so that when I was living in Cambodia gives you a longer time as a base or as a background for describing the other action that comes into that. And we often use it as well with things that are interrupted. So this is a good example because it's a live example. I was doing the language clinic when someone started annoying me with lots of calls and I got lots of notifications. Okay. Let me just switch it off so I should have done it before I started. There. Okay. So I was talking when the phone rang. So you're using the past continuous there as a longer action. I was talking before the phone rang. I was talking after the phone rang. And sometime in the middle, the phone rang. Okay. I was still talking for a second after the phone rang to say, excuse me, my phone just rang. I need to answer this. Okay? Like that. So basically, my simple explanation, you asked, is it for a long action? Yes. But that doesn't mean that every long action is continuous, okay? It's either because you're describing a long action in relation to other things that happened or something that is interrupted, okay, within that. And again, repeated action, as well. The doorbell was ringing all night last night and it woke me up, okay? It wasn't ringing. I don't mean that it rang necessarily continuously all night, but it rang again and again and again and again, and it woke me up. Okay, so those are some examples. I hope that's clear. It was very fast because it's a lot to talk about in 1 minute, but I tried my best with that. So if not, I'll give you more information and more links to practice with after this. Okay, good question here. Is the final S in the word unit, is this word pronounced z or s? Okay, I'm going to pass this over. While I look at other questions, I'm going to pass this over to all of you to answer. Say it to yourself. Tell me in the comments. Just put z or s. Is it, when I say universities, okay, am I saying z or s? Okay, so think about that one. Tell me in the comments, and I'll come back to it in a minute. From Anil Kumar Sahu, the restaurant has a friendly environment or a friendly... Okay, I don't understand this question. Anil, you might have to ask it again. You say the restaurant has a friendly environment or a friendly environment. I can't see a difference between your two questions there. So maybe try asking again, but explain to me a little bit more what you're asking. Maybe you want to ask about the verb. I don't know. Let's see. Francisco Vergara, what method do you recommend to learn more vocabulary? That's an easy one. I recommend using English in real life as much as you can. And by that, I suggest, for example, reading. Doesn't have to be books, could be books, could be newspapers, could be magazines, could be blogs, could be, you know, any website that you're interested in, anything that you like. But reading is probably the best single way to see, recognize, and start to think about words and phrases that you don't know that are new for you. Listening, obviously, is good as well. Listening and watching things on you know, movies, series, videos on YouTube, videos on TikTok, anything on, you know, that you Instagram, anything that you want for that. But the more that you engage with English, the more that you expose yourself and spend time, you know, just taking English in, finding things that you enjoy or that you're interested in, and then doing them in English, the more vocabulary you'll find. I guarantee it. If you go and watch any YouTube video right now, or if you go and open any newspaper article anywhere online, you will find that there are words and phrases that you don't know, that are new for you. Or you might find words that you do know, but used in a different way that is not as new for you, okay? Every time. So that means that there's an unlimited amount of places that you can actually find and learn new vocabulary. So you don't have to stick to one place or one language website or one app or anything else. Just find the things that you enjoy, whatever they are, whether it's, you know, from video games to astrophysics, it doesn't matter. The things that you enjoy, and then read about them, listen about them, watch about them. And when you find or hear or see or read new words that you think that could be useful, or, oh, that's interesting, make a note of them. Keep a note of them, keep a record of them in your phone, in a notebook, wherever, and then try to use them in your own speaking and writing. Join in conversations on social media, chat with friends, anything. But finding new words, reading, listening, watching, recording new words in your notebook, in your phone, on your laptop, whatever, and then trying to use these words in real life when you're speaking or writing. That's basically it. If you do that and you do it all the time, you know, regularly, a little bit every day or every couple of days, then you will learn lots of new vocabulary and you'll learn it quite fast. Okay. So that's my advice there. Okay. Let's see if Anil has come back with an explanation of the question. Not yet. Okay. Yeah, okay. It is here. Okay. So Anil's asked, so talking about that, do we talk, the restaurant has a friendly atmosphere or a friendly environment? In the context of a restaurant review, we're talking about a restaurant, I would tend to lean more towards atmosphere. We would use atmosphere and perhaps ambience or ambiance as well to talk about that, to talk about the feeling that you have when you're in the place and the general mood and the general kind of vibe. Vibe would be a more modern word to say as well. As a friendly vibe would work as well. So I would tend to use atmosphere there more. Ambience, whichever you want to pronounce it. Vibe, if you want to be very informal with that, is all okay. Friendly environment, I would tend to use that in a more formal context, maybe to talk about a workplace or something like that. You know, the office, I find the office to be a really friendly environment to work in, something like that. I'm not saying it's not possible for the restaurant. It is absolutely possible grammatically and everything in your sentence, but it wouldn't be my first choice. Okay. Yumna's really, really confused me this time with this question. Between Anil's question and your question, it seems, you know, it's like you're asking a question that you've already answered. How can I spell the checks? That's exactly how you would spell the checks. You're absolutely right. One person is a check. Two people are checks. That's it. You know how to spell it. You're right. Okay. So many questions. Hold on. Got to get back to the previous one. Okay. Can we meet every day on Facebook Live? I wish we could, but I think, you know, we all have bosses and I have bosses, and I think they might have something to say if I did this every day and didn't do any other work. So I would love to be here every day, but it's possibly not. We might be able to do a few more. I think in the coming 9 months or so, we might be at, we're doing 3 days at the moment, just so you know. We have every Tuesday, we have a grammar lesson. Every Wednesday, I'm here. And then every Friday, we have a workshop on exam skills or writing skills, reading skills, speaking skills, and so on. I think we will add in an one more day on Thursday, but we haven't decided yet what that will be, what type of program it will be. Maybe we'll ask you all in a poll and ask you what you would like, and we'll see. Okay. Right. Sorry about this. Just so many questions. I have to. I'm a fast reader, but I'm not that fast. Can you make students of? Okay, this is another. I'm getting a lot of teacher questions today, which is really nice, and it's lovely to have teachers here. And you know, nobody likes English teachers more than me in this world. But this is really for aimed at learners, and we have the Teaching English Facebook page where teacher questions go. So I would encourage you to ask questions over there when you have them. But Isabella's question is, how can you get students to use vocabulary they've just learned, for example, food role play at the restaurant? Okay, I'm going to answer this really quickly because I think it actually is relevant for people who are studying alone as well. My recommendation would be to think of it the other way around. Okay, don't think, okay, I'm going to teach all this restaurant vocabulary and then we'll add on an activity at the end where they can practice. Start with the activity. Start by thinking, okay, what's the situation? When would people need to use restaurant vocabulary? And what vocabulary would they need to use? Okay, and where would they use it and how would they use it? And then start by developing a task, whatever that task is. It could be a restaurant review, it could be a role play, like you say. In some cases it could even be, okay, let's actually go out and go someplace, you know, and order some food. There's lots you could do with that, but what is the activity? What's the goal that you want them to be able to do at the end from that? Start from that and try to make that as interesting, as fun, as real, and as relevant as possible. Okay. If you do that, then it's much, much easier to then build in the language in the course of your lesson to get them. Okay, so then, okay, what do we need? We need this, we need that. But you're working towards a goal that you've made clear at the beginning, and the goal is this: we're going to do this. And you know, to do that, you need some language. That would be my suggestion. Focus on the task, focus on the activity, and try to come up with the best activity you can first, and then think, okay, what are the stages that I'll go through to get different language into that and to get them ready for this activity? I think if you do that, you'll find that they'll really enjoy it and they'll get involved. Okay. 29 minutes, okay. And 29 minutes and only 100 questions to go. We're fine. Okay, Facebook user says, I'm confused about the past perfect continuous tense. I'm not going to talk about that just now because it's a little bit too specialized and it would be a little bit complicated, but I will give you some information about that to work on it. It's not that difficult, honestly. It might be confusing at the moment, but if it's confusing at the moment, it's only because I think you perhaps haven't seen it in context clearly enough to make it, you know, to help you understand what it's for. It's just like the past continuous tense, except it's moved back before something else in the past. So for example, I had been waiting in front of the restaurant for 20 minutes when my date finally arrived. Okay? It's the same as I was waiting there, but it's like it comes before. I'm emphasizing that my date arrived. My date arrived late. I had been waiting for 20 minutes. Okay, you see what I mean there? My date arrived late is the past simple action. I had been waiting 20 minutes is the continuous action for a long time that came before the person arriving, that came before the other action. That's all there is to it. But I'll give you some practice and some explanation in the notes to help you. Okay. Oh, there's so many good questions today. Going back to the earlier question, could I do this every day? I honestly sometimes wish that I could because there are so many good questions and I don't have time to answer them all. But this is a good question. I like this one from Olga AOL. Could you please explain the differences and the bad English number four. Could you please explain the difference and the correct phrase? Are you coming to the party? Or are you going to the party? Well, in terms of correct phrase, both are correct and both are possible. The difference is in the way that the person speaking, the way the person saying those sentences is thinking about the situation. Okay? So if I say, are you going to the party? We're both not at the party. We're both, thinking about the future, and we're both, it's not our party, it's someone else's party. Okay. And we're thinking, I'm asking, are you going to the party? Maybe I'm going to the party. Maybe I'm not. I don't know from the question. I could be, I might not be. But the question is, are you going to the party? I'm going to the party. Or I'm not going to the party. Are you going to the party? So we're imagining a situation where we're not at the party. The party is someone else's party, and we will go there. Okay? That's the first one. Are you coming to the party? Could have two possible meanings for this. Number one is I am at the party now. Okay? I'm here and you are not. So I'm calling you or texting you and saying, are you coming to the party? So I'm asking, are you coming here? To me, where I am. That's why I'd say, are you coming to the party? But, and this is where it gets a little confusing, perhaps, I can also use it when I'm imagining myself at the party in the future. So I can't, I could say something like, I can't wait for the party on Saturday. It's going to be fantastic. Are you coming? Okay. And that's because although we're both here and the party is there, and it's in the future like that. I'm imagining, I'm in my head, I'm going to the party. I know I'm going to the party. I'm at the party. And I can say to you, the party is going to be fantastic. I'm really looking forward to it. Are you coming to the party? Okay. So that's possible there. I could say, are you going to the party? And are you coming to the party in the same situation? And they both mean the same thing. Okay. But the other meaning is one, we're not at the party. We have to go there. Or the other, I am at the party and you are not. Are you coming? Okay. Fast explanation and a lot of explanation, but I hope it helped you, Olga. Okay. Ooh, another question from a teacher. Would you recommend a list of songs I can use for my KET A1 students, please. Tell me what age they are as well, if you can, in the in the comments. I can't. I'm not going to do it during the clinic here, but I might be able to help you after we finish here. Yes. Okay, Nasihat Muhammad, how to improve writing? Could you give some sources to improve writing? Yes, and yes. Okay. Okay, that's not good. Bear with me for a moment. I'm trying to show you something on screen and it went wrong. I'm going to try again. It's not, I'll just have to do this by speaking, which won't be as good, but let's see. Okay, not working. Having a technical problem there. Okay, simple answer to this question is writing is all about practice. Okay. The only way to get better at writing is by doing a lot of it. But what do you write about? That's sometimes the problem. Okay. Visit our website, our Learn English British Council website. You're watching on Facebook, so the link to our website is in our is it in our profile at the top of the page, or you can click on any of the posts that we share because we share posts every day. Visit our website. Look at the top of the website and you will see a section called skills. Under skills, you will see reading, listening, reading, and writing. And that is the best place possible to practice your writing. Okay? It has everything from beginner to advanced. It has everything from writing a text message to your friend to say, hello, I'll be late. I'll see you at 8 o'clock, up to writing a difficult essay or report in advanced English. Everything. Everything you could ever want to write. Emails, letters, reports, essays, personal profiles, CVs, you name it. It's all in there. And all you have to do is work through, find your level, work through the activities, find the ones that are useful for you, and practice them. And you can practice them at different levels. Okay. If you do that and you practice writing 2 or 3 times a week, just working with those, then your writing will improve very quickly, for sure. Okay. So that's my first advice, is, you know, visit our website, check out the skills section, check out the writing part. My other advice would just be write as much as you can, even if it's just for you. Keep, you know, make notes about things in English, chat with your friends in English, join in social media conversations in English. Okay, just try to write a little in English every day, and that will help you. Okay, moving on. A good question here. Do we always say on a farm, or are there times we could use in a farm? I'm not going to say there are never times we can use in a farm, because I'm sure that if I do say that, someone will come up with an example, or 5 minutes from now, I will think of an example. But what I will say is, it's really not very common. I can't think of an example now in my head. And I think of examples very quickly. So there might be some time it's possible, but in general, no, it's on a farm. I work on a farm. He works on a farm. He lives on a farm. There are lots of animals on the farm, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. On is the preferred and more common choice there. Okay, this is an excellent question from Olga. Okay, this is for everyone watching. Now, the way that Facebook and YouTube and so on work now is, you know, they've been trying for the last few years to stop you seeing so many things you don't want. So now what you have to do is you have to actively choose what you want to see. So you're on YouTube watching, Olga. So what you should do is you should go to our YouTube channel, subscribe, and then click to get a notification. There's a bell that you can click. And if you click on the bell to get notifications, then you will get a notification every time we go live or every time we upload a new video. Okay? That's the way to do it. You have to actively choose to do it. So go to the YouTube channel, subscribe, and then click on the option for the bell to get reminders. It's the same on Facebook. You need to, you know, where you've liked our page, if you have liked our page, then you have to go there, and then you can choose what you see. You can choose to see all of the posts from us. You can choose to see the notifications from us. And then if you do, you will get a notification when we go live every time. Okay. If you haven't liked our page and you haven't subscribed to our YouTube channel, why not? Okay. Do it now. Okay. Just hit like, hit subscribe. If you're on YouTube, hit like and hit follow. Okay. Zubir again, difference between check and check. The only difference is check with CK is the American English spelling. That's all. Okay, question. In Wednesday, is the D pronounced? Good question. Some people know, some people yes. If you listen to me say it, I say Wednesday. So you can hear that I do say that. It's a difficult one to make, but Wednesday. So yes. Okay, so my answer would be yes, but you might find some people that say, no, I say Wednesday. But okay, to you. Okay, Nung has a question, but I have to find the question. first. Okay. I'm not sure. I think you've got a spelling mistake there under, I think you mean competitions. I don't know is the answer to that question. Maybe tell me a little bit more about what competitions you mean, and maybe I can help. Okay. Okay. Imtiaz Patel asking about struggling with writing. Same advice. Go to our Learn English British website, Learn English British Council website. Go to skills and go to writing. And I guarantee if you do those activities that in just weeks, not months or years, in weeks, you'll see real improvement and real progress in your writing. Okay. Facebook user is asking, what do you mean by he has been committed an offense? In which tense? This is not possible. It's incorrect. It's wrong. So if you saw this someplace, then it's a mistake. Okay, it's just not possible. The use of been there would make it passive, but that's not possible in this context. Here you have the subject, he, and you have the object, offense. He has committed an offense. Okay. Active sense, present perfect tense. Okay. Sometime before now, he has committed an offense. There is no way that you can make that sentence passive with he at the beginning. If you changed it round and you say an offense has been committed, then that would be the passive form of the same thing. Maybe you don't know by who, or maybe it's not important to say who by, but an offense has been committed. So that's possible, but he has been committed an offense is impossible and is wrong. Okay? Strangest question of the day, but I'm going to show it because it's so strange. Can you show your shoes? No. Not just because it's a strange question, because physically it would be very, very difficult. And I'm, as you can possibly tell, I'm no gymnast. Okay. Okay, Dana. Which sentence is correct? There is only a couple of eggs in the fridge, or there are only a couple of eggs in the fridge? This is another one that I'm going to ask all of you to answer in the comments. Okay. I haven't forgotten this, and this is one from the beginning. I'm going to go back and check your answers on that in a minute or two as well. But for this one, tell me, is it there is a couple of eggs or there are a couple of eggs? Tell me in the comments, okay? Just write there is or there are, and let's see how many of you get it right, okay? I guess this is for Easter. Nung sharing an Easter bunny. Okay. Okay. Olga again. Sorry. I'm sorry. That's three questions for Olga. It's not fair for other people. There's a very quick one and it applies to everyone. Yes, all of these videos are available. All of them you can find in our live tab on YouTube and Facebook. Okay. There's tabs at the top. You'll see live. Go there. All of these are available. And we've got lots of them. Lots of them. I'm sure I've answered every question that there is possible to answer in English by now. Okay. Well, this is interesting. This is a question. Okay. I just said I've answered every question that could possibly be answered. But congratulations to IELTS Self Study. You've asked a question I've never been asked before. So well done. Should irony or sarcasm be taken into account in reading exercises? For example, in reading, if it says, according to the experts, lions are hunters. What a surprise. I can't off the top of my head think of a question in the reading test that might test this and might apply to this. But my answer is, should it be taken into account? Then yes, if something is placed in inverted commas like that, then it is showing the intent of the writer. It's showing the opinion, the sentiment, the, you know, the viewpoint of the writer by saying that the writer does not really think these people are experts or does not really respect these experts. So yes, it is possible that a question could be constructed that depends on you understanding that. I can't think of an example off the top of my head, and I don't think I've ever come across this in an IELTS test. But your question was just, should it be taken into account? Yes, I think, in other words, you should be aware of it. You should be aware that this is showing the opinion or the intent of the writer to call into question whatever the word or phrase is that they have put in inverted commas. So there you go. Question I've never been asked before. So congratulations, IELTS self-study. Okay. Seat, can you tell me about Sir? Because I'm a new subscriber. What's the topic? I'll say this for everyone again. Every Wednesday, I just come here because I like speaking to people. And I'm here to answer your questions. Whatever questions you have, I will try and answer as many as I can. That's one thing that we do. But we also have grammar lessons and vocabulary lessons on Tuesday. And we have workshops on skills like writing, reading, listening, and speaking on Friday. But today, you know, the Wednesdays, we don't have a topic. The topic is whatever you choose the topic to be. Okay, so it's all up to you. Sumaira Umar, I will share a link to you. Basically, the first step for improving your spelling mistakes is, like I said to the person about improving their vocabulary earlier, try to read more. Try to read as much as you can, because the more you read, pay attention. You know, you can use something like spell check on your phone or your computer when you write something. Find out what words that you spell wrong. Spell wrongly? Okay, whatever. Most of fifth English problem today. Honestly, I need to go back to school. Find out what words you have problems with. Maybe there are patterns. There are certain combinations of letters or certain types of word that are a problem for you. Double letters or something like that. Confusing two letters. Okay, so check using a spell checker on your computer, your phone, whatever, for that, to try to just, you know, identify and think about what mistakes you make. But then practice reading, okay? And just keep looking for words and keep looking at how they're used. And when you find words that are, you know, that you make mistakes with, just try to work on that. Try to notice them and try to remember. And then when you write, try and work on it. There are rules and there are things that can help you. I will share a website after we finish called howtospell.co.uk, I think, which covers every rule for English spelling and has hundreds of practice exercises to help you. But reading and noticing the spelling problems, training yourself to do that, I think is perhaps the most important thing. Okay, we've got the answers to the eggs now. Okay. And it's interesting. I'm going to flash out all the answers because we've got a 50-50 split. We've got there is a couple. We've got there is a couple. We've got there are a couple. We've got there are a couple. We've got there is. We've got there are. It's pretty much 50-50. And the reason this is confusing is because people look at the quantifier, the quantity phrase, a couple of, and think that a couple would make it singular in here. But no, it's a plural verb. There are eggs in the fridge. There are a few eggs in the fridge. A few has an indefinite article as well. But you wouldn't say is a few ever. It's not possible. It's there are a few, there are a couple of, there are a lot of. When the noun is plural, it's always going to be there are, okay? Not there is. So there you go. Okay. A lot of people answered that, so thank you. That's great. Hello. Unfortunately, your name is not in order to do this. You have to click to allow to show your name because you're in our private group, Facebook user. So I don't know who you are. I can't see it, but it's a long time since I watched the Language Clinic. How are you? I'm okay. Why is it a long time since you watched the Language Clinic? Where have you been? Okay. I hope you'll watch lots more in future. Okay. Welcome back. Okay. Right. I think we're coming up to the end now. So let me just see if I can. I need to go back and see if any of you answered on the z question. Okay. Yes, we got one from Nguyen Ha here who says z. Okay. Hold on. Oh, maybe Nguyen Ha might be the only person that answered that. Okay. So you're correct. Universities. Universities, not universities. Universities. No, it's z, not s. That was from one of our very first questions today. I'll just go back to find it for you so I can. So, for people who are looking at me and going, what is he talking about and why is he going s? Okay. Now I can't find the question. Okay, can't find the question, but the question was the sound at the end of the word universities. Okay, and that was the answer. So it's the z, not this. Okay. Anil's got a question here. I'm not quite clear what the question is. We have problems remembering what we learn. We, subject, have verb, object, problems. Okay. Okay. I'll have to think about that one because I'm not quite clear what you were asking then. Okay. Last question. I think it's another one from Anil. That's good because it's a nice short one that I can answer quickly. The difference between get married and marry. In terms of meaning, there isn't much difference. There's a slight difference, you know, in grammatically, if you were to break it down and really look at it, in that get married has a kind of passive sense in it. So it suggests, you know, that someone marries you. Like, so for example, some religious figure, you know, carries out the marriage ceremony or something like that. So there is a meaning of that that perhaps is that. But really, the difference is more in terms of, I think, just frequency and formality. We normally talk, most of the time, we talk about get married and got married. You know, so we'd say, I got married, whatever, 20, I have no idea. I got married X number of years ago, or I'm getting married next month. We normally use get married in that context for most of the things we talk about. I married her or she married him is possible as well. And the meaning is the same for that, but it's less common and it tends to only be used in certain contexts within that. So, you know, let me just think about that a little more. How I can explain it a little bit more. It would be unusual to say something like I married in 1997. That you know, you might find that in like a 19th century novel or something, but it would be unusual in everyday conversation. It'd be more, you know, you would normally say, I got married in 1997, something like that. Okay. Not to say that one is wrong, but just, you know, not really common in that. Okay. Very, very, very last question. I'm going to scroll right down to the bottom and see what the most recent question is. There are a couple of shoes. Yeah, today's a strange day for shoes. Yeah, a lot of shoes in the questions today. Okay, hello, Susan. Yes, haven't seen you for a long time. So I hope that now you're back, that you'll come every Wednesday to these sessions. Okay. There's a lot of teacher questions coming in, a lot of questions about teaching kids and young learners as well. So let me just, before I finish, let me just remind you that we have other account. Now, this question is on YouTube, but if you check out our Facebook pages, we have our Learn English Facebook page, which is where we are now. We also have our Teaching English Facebook page, which is fantastic for all teaching, from very young learners to adults and You can find the answers to all your questions there. We also have another Facebook page called Learn English Parents. And that's obviously for parents, but it deals with a lot of resources, activities, and advice that are very useful for teachers of kids as well. So check those out and see. Okay, oops, sorry. What was that? Okay. Okay, this is the very last question. I like this one because it's nice, easy, and I can answer it quickly. Okay. Is there a difference between work out, two separate words, and workout? Yes, and I'm very glad you asked. The difference is that work out as two separate words is normally a verb. It's a phrasal verb meaning to exercise. It has other meanings as well. You can work out a problem, work out a calculation, things like that. But since you're asking about it in connection with the single word workout, I think you mean the exercise meaning. So work out. He works out three times a week. Okay? That's a phrasal verb and it's two separate words. The noun, the word for the activity or the exercise that you do, is one word and it's workout. He had a good workout yesterday. He does three workouts every week. Okay, something like that. It's the noun. So when we put it together, that makes a noun, a workout. When we have it separately, it's a verb, work out. It can also be used, workout as a single word, it can also be used kind of like an adjective in what we might call a compound noun or something like that. You might say something like workout clothes, for example, okay? The clothes that you use to exercise in, or workout machine, something like that. That's possible to use it like an adjective as well. So as a single word, it's a noun, or a noun acting as an adjective. Two separate words, it's a verb, okay? And that's it. We've come to the end. That's my last question. Thank you all for watching. Thank you all for asking questions. I'll try to answer some of the ones that I didn't have time for in the comments. And some of them I'll answer next week at the start of the session next week. So with a lot of questions today, for a lot of new visitors, a lot of people asking about joining. So just before I finish, just let me remind you, we're here every week on Facebook and YouTube. Whichever you prefer to use, go to our channel, go to our Facebook page, go to our YouTube channel, click like, follow, and then choose the option. When you go there, you can press on the arrow and it will give you the options. Choose to get notifications or reminders. And then every time we're live or every time we post something new or useful, you will get a notification in your phone, on your computer, and then you can come and join us, okay? But we're here at the same time every week, so you can also just set an alarm for yourself on your phone and say, Language Clinic, same time next week, okay? And we'll be here. Anyway, that's it. I have to go now. We're at a full hour. Thanks for coming. I hope it's been useful. And if you just joined late, don't forget, you can always watch the recordings. You don't have to watch the whole thing. You can just skip through, look at the questions at the bottom, and if you see a question that's useful for you, listen to the answer, okay? Lots of these videos for you to look at. Try them out. I think they can be helpful, okay? But for now, it's bye for now.